Okay, the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3899 in the name of Alexander Stewart on NHS out-of-hours GP services. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd ask members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Alexander Stewart to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I am very grateful for the opportunity to open my member's business debate. The importance of NHS out-of-hour GP services cannot be underestimated. Indeed, according to Healthcare Improvement Scotland, primary care out-of-hour services are a fundamental part of our healthcare. The service provides support to those who require medical assistance out with normal GP surgery hours. This involves a number of healthcare professionals, agencies and support staff. They work together to provide a high quality of integrated services for patients, with many individuals going above and beyond to support these patients. I said in my original motion that the debate for Healthcare Improvement Scotland and many GPs have collectively acknowledged that the quality of safety of out-of-hours is extremely important. However, about 4 years ago, things appeared to slowly but surely be taking an about turn, Deputy Presiding Officer. Back in April 2018, I lodged a motion with deep concern as to the decision by Fife Health and Social Care Partnership to close the Glenrothes Hospital out of our services. During May that year, I sought assurances from the former Health Secretary that there were to be no further service reductions. The Health Secretary responded, indicating that recent changes were a short-term measure to ensure that appropriate levels of patient safety were maintained. I also took part in Jenny Gorus members' business debate on that very subject about Glenrothes. I well participated in Willie Rennie's members' business about St Andrews out of services. The primary care emergency services at these hospitals in Glenrothes, Dunfermline and St Andrews all remain closed for after they were forced to be suspended due to staff shortages back in 2018. Meanwhile, NHS Forth Valley has been escalated to stage 3 on NHS Board Performance Escalation Framework. All these concerns have sadly proven not to be in vain, Deputy Presiding Officer, as we are now facing grave issues in many of our out-of-services length and breadth of Scotland. Assurances were sought from the constituency member for Clackmannanshire and Dunblane and the Clackmannanshire Council leader in December 2021. A press statement was issued by them and they indicated that they had received assurances from the Health Board that they were committed to providing services in Clackmannanshire. Deputy Presiding Officer, I have been contacted by a number of highly concerned, even frightened individuals about the possibilities of Forth Valley out of our services and what is taking place. I am utterly shocked and dismayed to now see reports that this is being dismantled slowly but surely. Prior to the NHS Forth Valley control, Clack's emergency doctor services were working Monday to Friday and at weekends, with two doctors and three doctors overlapping and other doctors on standby, ensuring that there was receptionists, a car and drivers. Falkirk doctors were also working Monday to Friday and weekends with receptionists, drivers and two cars. Stirling doctors operated from Monday to Friday and weekends, with rural Stirlingshire being covered by their own GPs. When NHS Forth Valley took over the services, they had 5 GPs supplemented with local GPs covering a high level and 4 GPs and 4 drivers. All centres were fully staffed 7 days a week after Clackmannanshire, which I have also indicated it lost overnight a GP, and as soon Forth Valley took over and that service started to be diminished. Months later, Clackmannanshire was reduced to 1 GP an evening, with many patients having to travel to other centres when Clackmannanshire's base GP was on visits. A freedom of information sent to me recently showed staffing levels fluctuating over the following years, with Clackmannan centres being systematically run down since 2017. This initially concerned, we were looking at what was happening on public holidays and shortages and weekends. The running down of continually and shortening opening hours at weekends, followed by regular weekend closures, and now we only see 3 evenings a fortnight. Despite claiming in the FOI that Health Board would continue to deal with the 3 centres, I am repeatedly informed that there have been a removal of drug bags, drivers, cars and receptionists from Clackmannanshire and Stirling over the last few months. Deputy Presiding Officer, NHS Forth Valley had 5 vehicles a few years ago, 4, and then they were reduced to 2 one in Larbert and one car operating on other occasions. Moreover, on the days that Stirling and Alloa had no clinicians, there was no driver, there was no drug bags availability in any of these centres. Staffing levels are a fraction of the initial levels that were talked about, we indicated. Calls to Forth Valley via the NHS 24 line are triaged into the following areas, Deputy Presiding Officer. A doctor to be phoned. Patients to be given centre attention within timescales of 1 hour, 2 hour or 4 hours. Patients to receive home visits between 1 hour, 2 hour or 4 hours. During COVID, all these calls were triaged by NHS 24 and re-triaged to NHS Forth Valley. Deputy Presiding Officer, there is still this case today, despite the pandemic being nearly but over. That is still the case we have today. Now Forth Valley have adopted a policy of comfort calling by non-clinician staff to apologise for the delays and ask the patient if they still wish to remain on the list. However, as we have seen historically over Forth Valley goes into escalation, that means that the standard diminishes. Indeed, on occasions, we've gone into the black situation, which as we know is the top priority, Cabinet Secretary, and there's no service at all. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, staffing levels and GPs' cooperation is vitally important, and Forth Valley ensured their patients that they would have a good service, and they did have a good service at one point. Only now we find that one clinician on duty for a population of around 300,000 patients, wow. That is causing real concern and is compromising patient care, Cabinet Secretary. Clinicians and drivers and receptionists have all been cut, despite there not being any drop in the demand. Indeed, Forth Valley have called the demand causing that only in reality a quarter of calls that they cannot answer because they do not have the staff. This is a wholly unacceptable situation, Deputy Presiding Officer, and one which needs to be addressed by the Cabinet Secretary as a matter of urgency. I look forward to hearing his response in the summing up in this debate. Presiding Officer, GP out of our services are vitally important. Therefore, the Scottish Government and local health boards need to strive to ensure they are maintained, they are retained and they are sustained, because at the moment they are failing patients and putting lives at risk. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. Now move to the open debate. I call first Emma Harper to be followed by Tess White for around 4 minutes. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate and I thank my colleague Alexander Stewart in securing it. I supported this motion as it was quite positive, which is kind of different than what we've just heard in the contribution. I want to start by paying tribute to all of Scotland's GPs, as well as the support staff, the advanced nurse practitioners, NHS 24 call handlers and the drivers. As Mr Stewart's motion mentions, their work is absolutely crucial. Presiding Officer, the primary care out of our services are a fundamental part of our healthcare in Scotland, and the service provides support to those who require medical assistance out with the normal GP surgery hours. Out of hours involves a number of agencies and healthcare professionals working together to provide an integrated service for patients. The quality and safety of out of hours care is extremely important, and I agree patients should have access to consistent, high quality standards of care across the country. The picture with out of hours care in Scotland is comparatively a good one compared to other UK nations. And indeed, each year across Scotland, around 870,000 patients use out of hours primary care services, resulting in just under 1 million consultations. Home visits account for 1 in 5, which is about 187,000 contacts with out-of-hours primary care services, with over half of the contacts, that's 57%, taking place in a primary care emergency centre. Children under 5, women in their 20s, people aged 75 and over are the most common age groups of patients contacting out-of-hours primary care services. And treatment was completed by out-of-hours primary care services for just over half of the patients who were in contact with them. Mm-hmm. Only 3% of contacts with the services resulted in a referral to A&E or a minor injuries unit, showing how out-of-hours services are helping to reduce acute hospital admissions. These statistics are welcome, and they show the importance of the out-of-hours service as a way to reduce hospital admissions. They are also an important way of providing reassurance to the public that care will be provided out with GP hours. Presiding Officer, Andrew Buis, the Chair of the Scottish GPE Committee, recently wrote a blog reflecting on NHS out-of-hours care in Scotland now compared with previously in 2004 with that model. In the blog, Dr Buis remarks how out-of-hours, which previously was solely doctor-based and involved doctors driving long, long on-call hours, often driving themselves, has now been transformed into a more slick operation where the primary care sector work together. And Dr Buis says in his blog, "When I think back to what out-of-hours was like before 2004, then what a luxury it feels like now to have a driver. He just sits back, having read the patient's notes, he lets someone else worry about finding the right house, and with the safety knowledge that when you are on the call, there is someone outside waiting on you." He continued when he said, "You work at your own pace alongside other GPs and nurse practitioners, all picking from a pool of patients who have been triaged by NHS 24 and given an appointment time slot. The cases were all appropriate, a mixture of children, coughs, urinary symptoms with occasional rash, chest pain or alcohol withdrawal. Compared to daytime general practice, he says, it was so much more straightforward. There was no shopping lists, no paperwork." He said also, "Out of hours is part of general practice. We as GPs need to support it and not give it over to hospital care." These words speak for themselves, and while there is, of course, room for improvement in the out-of-hours service, as there are in other parts of our healthcare system, I want to recognise the hard work of all the staff involved to make it what it is today. This is in contrast, Presiding Officer, to the latest ask of the new UK Government Health Secretary, Theresa Coffey, by the Doctors Association UK. DA UK is asking for urgent action to address GP retention, as they are predicting that 16 million people in the UK could lose access to a GP within a decade. So in closing, Presiding Officer, again, I welcome this debate and the opportunity to speak highly about Scotland's out-of-hours sector. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. I now call Tess White to be followed by Carol Mochan for around 4 minutes, Ms White.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I thank Alexander Stewart for securing this time for the members' business on out-of-hours GP services. It helps to bring into focus how pivotal these services are in delivering primary care. When GP surgeries are closed during the evenings, weekends, festive periods and public holidays. That's as much as 70% of the week. A reminder that general practice is not just between 8 o'clock in the morning and 6:30 p.m. but 24/7. It's important to emphasise at the outset that out-of-hours GP services deal with close to 1 million patient consultations each year. Those patients include people with long-term conditions, palliative care needs, and mental health problems. For parents with babies and young children, and for over 75s, the service is especially invaluable, as it is for those in rural areas. In many parts of Scotland, the service is also desperately overstretched. Even before the pandemic, BMA Scotland's chair of the Scottish GP Committee argued that the root cause was simply the fact that there are not enough GPs. There's not enough GPs working in Scotland, and those who are face such demanding workloads that adding out of hours is just a step too far. This is an all too familiar theme. In 2015, the Independent Review of Primary Care Out-of-Hours Services stated that, and I quote, "serious GP shortages were compromising the sustainability of out-of-hours services, which remain fragile, and may worsen without resolute and urgent action." Time and time again, the Scottish Government has been warned about NHS workforce planning. Yes, by political parties, but more importantly, by the people that matter on the front line. Kemnay Medical Group in Aberdeenshire has lost 4 GPs. In the Kemnay Community Newsletter, staff from the surgery described a creaking system where the pressures on clinicians have continued to grow, the demand for our time has rocketed, and political promises of help have failed to materialise. They added that the national GP shortage is felt across Scotland, but particularly in the North East. Break in medical practice, for example. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. I appreciate that you've allowed me to come in here. Would Tess White agree that the ScotGem programme, which is focusing on rural recruitment for GPs, do you not think that that's something that's unique to Scotland and it's actually helping get us GPs rurally?
Thank you. Through the chair, please. Tess
yes,
White.
Thank you for that intervention, Emma Harper. So in the committee yesterday, we heard evidence that was the healthcare committee, that it is a step in the right direction, but really it's only scratching the surface. It's still not good enough. We can't get enough GPs. So break in medical practice, for example, is surviving with two GPs and regular locums at significant cost. Inverbervie medical practice is struggling to meet demand. And some surgeries haven't survived at all. I recently raised the example of Freakham Health Centre in Angus with the Cabinet Secretary. The GP surgery achieved a 95.46% positive score in the latest health and care experience survey. It was the highest across Tayside, yet it closed in May this year, displacing more than 3,000 patients. And the reason for the closure? NHS Tayside wrote to patients to say that the main issue that is facing primary care and GP services is that there are not enough GPs. Deputy Presiding Officer, people in the North East and across Scotland are paying the price for years of poor workforce planning by the SNP government. Now this government is playing catch-up, pledging 800 GPs by 2027 in various phases. But it's abundantly clear the NHS needs more GPs now to fill existing vacancies and to cope with increasing workload demands. The Health Secretary says he's working relentlessly on this issue, and frankly, we're tired of his relentless excuses. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. White. I now call Carol Mochen to be followed by Brian Whittle for around 4 minutes, Ms. Mochen.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank Alexander Stewart for bringing this debate to the Chamber. It is, of course, right that we recognise the absolutely vital contribution out of hours GP services make to healthcare provision across Scotland. And it is also right that we stress how important it is for all regions of NHS Scotland, supported by the Scottish Government, to ensure out of hours GP services can not only continue to operate, but continue to operate providing the highest levels of care. And I think if people are absolutely honest, if they look at their inboxes, constituents are telling us there is strain on GP services and on GP out-of-hour services. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, it is important to note that excellent work goes on within our NHS staff, in hospitals, at primary care settings and in the community. The work they do always goes above and beyond expectations, particularly in recent times where people have needed that bit of extra help, and the contributions, as mentioned in the motion, of healthcare professionals, support staff, drivers and others must not be understated. Deputy Presiding Officer, primary care out-of-hour services are now embedded as a fundamental part of our healthcare provision in Scotland. Many of us remember our local GPs providing 24-hour cover, where a variety of models were used, but if, like me, you lived in a rural area, your own GP and GP practice attended if you called a GP out overnight. Of course, since then, there has been a wide variety of changes in out-of-hour services, with them coming under the control of the health boards in 2004, in large part, as we have heard from other members, because of the increasing demands for services out-of-hours and the traditional models just not able to cope with the service. However, it is important that we learn from the past. In my own constituency, my own region, Mauchline and Carton, where I live, there are significant challenges facing GP services, such as in Ballochmyle Medical Practice, where I've had a number of residents contacting me, waiting significant lengths of time for appointments, facing challenges with administration of prescriptions, lengthy telephone queues when they phone up, appointments that can't be, you know, they can't get an appointment with the GP, and residents are finding it difficult to balance their own lives and actually get a GP appointment. The pressure on day-to-day GP services is severe. Despite the best efforts of our workforce, they clearly need to be more supported, and we must ensure that that pressure does not spill over further into our out-of-hours services, on which there is now a significant reliance to get some treatments. Deputy Presiding Officer, I repeat that we cannot forget the lessons of the past, and we must ensure there is sufficient resources to meet demand and to ensure patients can access high-quality care in both the GP and the out-of-hour GP services. Deputy Presiding Officer, in the short term that I have left, I want to focus my attention on the work and commitment of all those staff groups under enormous pressure. It cannot be understated. Across my South of Scotland region, I have visited over the summer a number of services and staff groups working in a variety of settings within the NHS. It is not an exaggeration to say NHS staff across the board, from nursing staff, porters, caterers, cleaners, those working within GP practices are exhausted and demoralised and feel undervalued by the current government and the structures in place. Staff need a proper plan for pay, for recruitment, for wellbeing provision, and that includes those working in out-of-hour services. It will truly value our NHS and our NHS staff if this government acts. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I once again thank all of those who contribute to the delivery of our out-of-hours GP services in my region, South of Scotland and beyond. The work that they do is invaluable to ensure that people's medical needs are met in those hours that perhaps others are not at work. And I thank the member for bringing the debate to the chamber. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochan. And I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Monica Lennon for 4 minutes, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also thank my colleague, Alexander Stewart, for bringing this crucial and timely debate to the chamber. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, it would be easy to take this opportunity to just have a pop at the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Government and sit down. However, I think there's a crisis here that goes beyond politics and point scoring. Now, I'm going to highlight what is happening at the coalface, which I'm sure won't be easy listening for the Cabinet Secretary, because I am sure he is fully aware of the acute nature of the challenges the health service faces, and therefore he faces. Now, I would say, Deputy Presiding Officer, that the level of GP services across Scotland is not uniform. I think in my own area, I have reports of good levels of GP access in Troon, for example. However, an extremely worrying is the inability to see a GP in parts of South Lanarkshire. I know of patients who have been attempting to see a GP at certain practices, calling up to be asked the nature of the issue, being told that a doctor will call them back, only to get a text later that says they're only seeing emergency cases. I know of a constituent who's been attempting to access a blood test for over 3 months because of persistent worrying symptoms, who is yet to speak to a healthcare professional. There is a chronic lack of GPs in certain areas, which of course has a huge knock-on effect for the out-of-service GP service. If GPs can't cover daytime surgeries, how can they be expected to deliver an effective out-of-hours service? Furthermore, the private sector is reporting that their waiting lists are growing ever longer, a symptom of those turning to the private sector because of a lack of access to NHS services. So what about those who do not have this route open to them? Especially post-COVID, where we are learning about the inevitable backlog in non-COVID-related conditions such as cancers and elective surgery and dementia and so on. It is no wonder that A&E departments are under such pressure as a last resort to access healthcare. Now, I listened to the Cabinet Secretary on the radio this morning suggesting that one of the issues in the A&E waiting times was that people are arriving sicker than they did before. And I think this is a symptom of not being able to access healthcare when their condition was less acute. It's not just that though, Deputy Presiding Officer. Consider that Scotland has been the unhealthiest nation in Europe for some time. The highest levels of obesity, drug and alcohol deaths, diabetes, heart conditions, reducing life expectancy and so on. So it has to be a concern that, in the Cabinet Secretary's own words, patients are getting even sicker. And the issues today, I think, are a symptom of policy decisions taken a decade ago or so. And we have to accept that cutting nursing midwife places, as well as putting a cap on Scottish applicants for medical school, which of course speaks to the shortage of GPs. The reality is that there's no quick fixes either. I think there is certainly many things we could do to improve the situation while we look at the long-term strategy to support an NHS. Things like workforce planning, which has been a recurring issue since ever I was in this chamber. Improving the working environment and conditions, helping our NHS staff to have the options of a healthier, more active lifestyle and so on. Long term, I have been an advocate of planning to gradually move investment upstream into the more preventative agenda, thus improving the health of the nation with all the benefits to communities and society that that would bring. It's not about saving money, it's about gradually being able to redistribute that money into other areas of healthcare as progress is made. The problem, of course, Deputy Presiding Officer, is that deploying that kind of strategy takes way longer than a parliamentary term, and I think that's something that parliaments are just not good at. It's the biggest failing, in my opinion, of this place, having complete control of health, with the ability to do things differently and to innovate, yet the governments in this place have failed to do so. The strain GPs are under trying to deliver out of our service is a symptom of this short-termism. Perhaps this is an opportunity for the Cabinet Secretary to look at the long-term view for once to the benefit and sustainability of our NHS. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Whittle. And I call Monica Lennon for up to 4 minutes, Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to start by thanking Brian Whittle, actually, who I bumped into earlier today, and he told me about the debate that was happening, and I wasn't due to speak to have another event tonight. But for every single member of this Parliament, this is really at the heart of our inboxes, as Carol Mockin said. It's what people come to our surgeries about, and frankly, it's what we all fear, because we all rely on the NHS, we all have families who do so, and I've been very grateful to have care from my GP during the pandemic, during even recent months. But I know many, many people who have found it so hard to get that face-to-face contact, to even get through on the phone. And I do want to take the opportunity, like others have done so, including Emma Harper, to thank everyone working across health and social care, everyone in primary care, from the receptionist to the practice nurse, the GP, everyone. The NHS is a family. And every part of it needs to be nurtured and looked after. So we do have a duty in here to give people confidence, to show that we do value the workforce, and certainly not to scare people or give people a sense that they won't get support from the NHS. But we all know constituents who have had to endure long waits for ambulances, have sat on the phone and tried sometimes dozens of times, sometimes hundreds of times to get through, whether it's to, out of hours at NHS 24. So that is the reality. So it would be good to come in and keep it all positive, but we are living in scary times. We all do local press releases, we all do social media. The word crisis is perhaps overused, but I fear that what we're seeing right now in our NHS has become the new normal. We've become so desensitised to words like crisis and catastrophe that it's really hard now to come in here and feel that our words actually have meaning. I do worry, as someone who lives in Lanarkshire and represents constituents there, that code black is becoming the new normal for us in Lanarkshire, and we cannot allow that to happen. And the Cabinet Secretary knows that I will work with him and his team and colleagues right across the chamber. Frankly, I don't care what party people belong to. This is bigger than any party logo or any soundbite, because, you know, the reality is many of us fear getting ill. And many of my constituents in Lanarkshire, they can't afford to go private and bypass the NHS. So we have to fix this. There are immediate things that we can do, and there are longer term things, but we have to show our constituents, the wider public in Scotland, that we have a plan. So we do happy to take an intervention, yep.
Audrey Nicholl.
Just on that point that you've made, I wonder if you would agree that the sort of new triage models that GPs are introducing, for example, advanced nurse practitioners, sort of stabilising daytime services in a GP practice, for example, goes some way to reducing the pressures on out-of-hour services, as was highlighted by a GP in my constituency recently.
Monica Lennon.
Absolutely, and it's really important to hear about good practice and what is working well. But when I listen to constituents of mine and people in my own family who work in the NHS, staff don't have time to go for a pee, never mind go and do extra training. There's people who want to advance and stay in our NHS, but they don't feel valued, they do feel burnt out. And, you know, whilst we've heard about, you know, additional recruitment, trying to find people, we're losing people. We're not retaining the talent, the good people that we have. So these are concerns, I think, that we all share. So I'll just finish by reminding the Cabinet Secretary. I did email him again recently about the Code Black in Lanarkshire, and an offer from me on behalf of my constituents to work with him and his team. We need to pull people together, and hopefully in closing, we'll hear from the Cabinet Secretary that a date is in the diary and will be shared with colleagues soon. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Lennon. And I now call on Humza Yousaf to respond to the debate, Cabinet Secretary, for around 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Alexander Stewart for bringing this debate to the Chamber? Can I thank members for their contributions? I'm going to try my best to get through as many of the concerns that have been raised. But can I start where a lot of members did, most members did, and that is to thank all of our GPs and all of those involved in GP out-of-hours services right across the country. GPs, absolutely, receptionists, AHP staff, all of those people who make up the multidisciplinary teams right up and down the country. I'm really pleased Monica Lennon mentioned the receptionists, because we know they've had a particularly tough time in GP practices up and down the country. It's why we ran the receptionist campaign, where receptionists are not gatekeepers trying to keep people away from their GP, but they're asking these questions to direct people in the right places. And I know that can be a really difficult job, and our receptionists have done it fantastically well. In terms of some of the issues raised, and I'll certainly address very specific issues that have been raised by the member around Forth Valley in just a second, but I'll pick up on some of the more general comments first, and I'll come back to Alexander Stewart's specific points. On Emma Harper was absolutely right to put some context around this debate in relation to out-of-hours. The transformation in out-of-hours, as described by Dr. Buist in that excellent blog, actually, is really worth a read. Now, that's not to sit on our hands and say, look, everything is rosy. I'm not suggesting that. I think people in this chamber would know me well enough and have heard me enough times publicly, whether it was this morning on the radio or whether it's been in this chamber on many occasions, that I completely understand the level and depth of challenge and significant challenge our NHS in its broadest possible sense, and indeed social care, are currently under. So nobody here, nobody in the government, neither myself nor the First Minister in the many conversations I have with her about the NHS, are under any illusion that somehow things are all rosy in the park. We know there are significant challenges, including in out-of-hours, but I think context is hugely important. If I may turn to the specific points that Alexander Stewart asked about, again, I will be absolutely candid and upfront. The out-of-hours service provided in Forth Valley is not good enough. And that is why I understand in the CEO's invitation, Forth Valley CEO's invitation, Sir Lewis Ritchie, who is, of course, an expert on out-of-hours services, has been asked to come back in to review that service. That review is due to start early next month, I think on the 5th of October, and I would be pleased to furnish Alexander Stewart with more detail in writing once that review, of course, begins to kick in, if he wants. I know Sir Lewis Ritchie well, and his approach has always been a very open one with elected members. I'm sure he himself would be happy to furnish Alexander Stewart with details of that review. In terms of action that has been taken, there is an improvement plan in place from Forth Valley, and some of those actions, well, all of those actions, we are monitoring very, very closely. They have recruited a GP to the out-of-hours service, but they've also recruited an additional two GPs onto the staff bank who will help support that out-of-hours service. They're not site-specific, they'll work across the three sites in Forth Valley. They also have a GP on call in service to support the service. But it isn't just about the GPs. As important as they clearly are in out-of-hours service, Forth Valley have also recruited an ANP and looking to recruit another ANP too. They're also working with the ambulance service and who now provide a paramedic to support the out-of-hours service on Saturday and Sunday. Paramedic support for home visits in Forth Valley are working with SAS on advanced paramedic practitioner appointments. And lastly, in terms of that improvement plan, I note Forth Valley also from the 3rd of October, so under a fortnight's time, there will be a pool of drivers who will be available to bring patients to the out-of-hour services, most notably, to support people with no transport from socially deprived areas. So I hope that gives at least a flavour, at least some level of comfort and reassurance that nobody is sitting back and accepting the position of Forth Valley. There is action being taken. But again, I'm happy to talk offline to Mr. Stewart if he wishes about more detail are in what's happening in Forth Valley. In relation to GPs more generally, again, nobody's going to get an argument from me when they talk about some of the access issues to primary care that they're saying they are receiving from their constituents. I get it from constituents, family members, friends of mine, and I know that has been an issue, particularly in when we were in the teeth, in the grip of this pandemic, in the really difficult phases of this pandemic, where of course IPC controls were at their highest, and therefore of course there was real challenges accessing GPs. There are still challenges, and I raise this issue when I met with Dr. Kennedy this morning, the new chair of the BMA, and we're going to have a broader meeting with more of his council members. He absolutely accepted that we would work collaboratively to increase, where clinically appropriate, more face-to-face. I would say we should also, I think nobody will be in disagreement about this, we all accept, I think, that should be part of a hybrid model. We should retain the video consultation, phone consultation for those that want it. For some people, I prefer to use a phone consultation and have used it the last couple of times that I've been in contact with my GP. It means less inconvenience for me and disruption to my day. That doesn't suit everybody by any stretch of the imagination. So face-to-face appointments are very important. Indeed, in response to a question from Kenneth Gibson a couple of weeks ago now, I made the point that there's more work to be done with GP practices around pre-bookable appointments, which I think could make a significant difference. And I noticed actually the Secretary of State in England was saying something similar. So these problems are shared right across the United Kingdom. In terms of Scotland's own record on GPs, again, I wouldn't disagree that we don't need more. That's why we have that 800 recruitment target. But it's not waiting till 2027 for that 800. We will recruit now. So we have 277 recruited. Of course, I give way to Brian Whittle.
Brian Whittle.
Appreciate the Cabinet Secretary giving way. And I think he knows in the last term I had the health portfolio back then and was in the Health and Sport Committee. When we were 860-odd GPs short, and the previous Cabinet Secretary came up with this, that we're going to recruit 800 new GPs within the next decade. But Audit Scotland said then that didn't take into account those that would retire, and after that 10 years would still be over 650 GPs short. And I would suggest perhaps that's going to get worse now. So perhaps it's time to maybe reflect and have a look again at that plan.
Cabinet Secretary.
So Brian Whittle makes a good point. I thought his contribution was very good too, I should say, that this is not just about recruitment, it's about retention. A couple of members referenced retention, and so there's no point recruiting 800 to a leaky bucket and you're losing that in the other end. So again, a lot of my conversation with Dr. Kennedy this morning was about retention, and I'll say more certainly in the coming couple of weeks when I have a ministerial statement due on retention in particular and what we can do to support retention for GPs. But Scotland, we do comparatively well. We have 95 GPs per 100,000 in Scotland. That is in comparison to 78 in England, 80 in Wales, and 75 in Northern Ireland. I'm aware that I am over time, so I will end by saying on Karen Watkins, very important points around pay and around staff burnout and well-being. Let me say these are of the highest priority, and I'm getting around the table with trade unions again. I want to give a fair settlement, one that is, of course, and has to be affordable within our health budget, but I accept that their members have rejected our 5%, so it's incumbent on us to come forward with an improved offer, which I will, and well-being is very, very high up our agenda. And Monica Lennon's point, and I promise you, President, I will end on this, multidisciplinary teams are very, very important. We've recruited many staff, over 3,000 staff since 2018, as part of the multidisciplinary teams. Code Black can never be the new normal, and I won't allow it to be the new normal. And therefore, the exit plan from Lanarkshire out of Code Black is exceptionally important. Forgive me if a date hasn't been given to her. There's been obviously disruption because of events most recently, but I would expect that meeting to take place and a date to be sent to her and other Lanarkshire MSPs very, very soon, because I know she wants to work collaboratively on this. So if I can end by thanking our GPs and all of the staff involved in GPs out of our services for the phenomenal work that they do and the lives they save, and they have this government's full attention but also appreciation.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.